Hello and a very warm welcome to latest case analysis series. This is Monica Rahar and today we'll be discussing the case of Mukesh Singh versus the state narcotic branch of Delhi. It's a Supreme Court decision which is dated 31st of August 2020. It was decided by a bench consisting of Honorable Justice Arun Mishra, Justice Indira Banerjee and Justice Vineet Saran. The issue of law before the court's consideration was whether trial in NDPS matters is vitiated and the accused become entitled to get acquitted merely because the investigating officer and the complainant is the same person. Now let's proceed with the brief facts of the matter. So the leading authority governing this issue of law was the case of Mohan Lal versus State of Punjab, wherein the Supreme Court had held that in case the investigating officer and the complainant is the same person, then the trial is in fact vitiated and the accused is entitled to acquittal. Now, when the case of Mukesh Singh came before another bench of the Supreme Court, the bench noted or doubted the correctness of Mohan Lal's case and hence the matter was referred to the present bench in order to address the above stated issue of law. Now, let's proceed and understand the case of the accused followed by the case of the state. So, the counsel for the accused contended that the Mohan Lal's case, it was based on principles of constitutional and criminal jurisprudence and therefore it reflected a very correct position of law. Then the counsel laid down the scheme of the NDPS Act before the court in order to bring home two separate points. A being that by virtue of Section 35 and Section 54 of the Act, a reverse burden of proof is placed on the accused and therefore an accused, whenever he is found in possession of any prohibited substance, a presumption of his guilt is given and in fact the courts are mandated to presume culpability of the accused unless contrary is proved. Now let's understand the meaning of the term reverse burden of proof. So ordinarily the burden of proof is on the prosecution. However, whenever this burden of proof is reversed, then the onus shifts from the prosecution to the accused and now the accused is under the obligation to prove by preponderance of probabilities that he has not committed the offense for which he is charged. Now the second point which was contended by the counsel was that seeing the fact that a reverse burden of proof is placed upon the accused, the NDPS Act has certain safeguards which provides or protects the accused. The safeguards is that the recovery and the investigation, it is to be made by different officers. That is officers who are empowered under Section 42 and under Section 53 of the Act. Now let's understand the powers and the functions of these two officers. So a 42 section officer, he has a limited role of entry, search, seizure and arrest and he does not have any power of investigation. So that is to say he is the complainant. After having made search and seizure and arrest, he is to hand over the result of such search and seizure, be it the arrested person or the article seized, to A, the officer empowered in this regard under Section 53 of the NDPS Act or the officer in charge of the police station who is vested with the power of investigation under the Code of Criminal Procedure. Now, whenever search and handing over is done, then the investigating officer receives the information for the very first time and then the investigation commences. So by this point, what is meant is that the complainant here is the Section 42 officer while the investigating officer is the Section 53 officer. Now let's proceed and understand what happens in a scenario when these two entities is in fact the same, or to say when 42 section officer continues the investigation itself. So the counsel contended that the NDPS has special provisions like any secret information which is received by a Section 42 officer, it is to be provided to his superior, but by virtue of Section 68, force cannot be used to extract the source of such an information. Thus, the received information is not verified because Section 42 officer, he himself is the complainant and he alone is the witness of the fact of possession. Now let's understand, given such a scenario, how does the presence of Section 53 officer ensures fairness and strikes the balance which is needed? So he is required to verify these facts during the investigation and also under Section 52 subsection 4, he is to take measures for disposal of the arrested person and seize products. Now how does he do that? The arrested person is produced before the magistrate while the seized narcotic substances are dealt with in accordance with Section 52A of the Act. Now, this is a very important point which we need to understand. So, during investigation, the conduct of an officer under Section 42 can also be investigated, and if any malafide intention is attributed to such an officer, then it can be punished under Section 58, which makes it a cognizable offense. Now, here's the catch. So, we need to understand what happens if the investigation is in fact continued by the Section 42 officer. So, if the investigation is continued by a Section 42 officer, then it will be against the scheme of the Act, because obviously then he will not proceed against himself and he will not file charge sheet against himself, and therefore the provisions of the NDPS Act at large and specifically Section 58 would be rendered redundant. So, this was the contention of the Council. Fourthly, the Council, proceeding further in this direction, stated that the NDPS Act does not contemplate joint authorizations. Separate officers with specified roles under Section 42 and 53 are provided on purpose, and this shows the legislative intent. And at the last, he contended that establishing the offense beyond reasonable doubt is difficult due to the tainted investigation by the complainant, Section 42 officer, who is a witness himself to a very substantial ingredient of an offense in the NDPS Act, which is the factum of possession and recovery. Now let's proceed and understand the case of the Solicitor General of India. So the Solicitor General, he drew parallels between the Code of Criminal Procedure and the NDPS Act, and then comparing these two, he advances submissions. So the first submission was that the provisions of Chapter 12 of the CRPC, which is informant of the offense is a police officer. So these provisions are attracted in the present matter. And while making a reference to sections 154, 156 and 157 of the CRPC, he contended that CRPC, the scheme of the CRPC, it does not place any bar on a police officer who receives and records such an investigation, such an information of commission of a cognizable offense, to investigate the same. So what he essentially was contending that the provisions of Chapter 12 of the CRPC will be applicable in the present case. And in the CRPC, there is no bar. That is, a police officer who receives and records information of a cognizable offense is not barred from investigating the same. Thirdly, he contended that CRPC itself has provisions for vitiation and non-vitiation of trial when illegality is committed by the magistrate, but not by the investigating officer. And the issue of law before us in this present matter is, will the entire NDPS proceeding be vitiated if the complainant and the investigating officer be the same person? That is, if any illegality is committed at the instance of the investigating officer. So the Solicitor General of India contended that no such provision of vitiation is provided in the CRPC, and the provisions of CRPC is applicable in the present matter. Fourthly, the Solicitor General contended that irregularity in investigation would not lead to acquittal unless failure of justice is shown. Also, he brought attention to Section 114 of the 114 Illustration E of the Indian Evidence Act, which permits courts to raise a presumption that the official acts have been regularly performed, and any presumption contrary to this will have to be proved by a concrete set of evidence. The Solicitor General then, refuting each and every authority or case law which was cited by the accused in support of his case, stated that the cases, be it the case of Bhagwan Singh versus State of Rajasthan, Megha Singh versus State of Haryana, or the case of Mohanlal itself, the decisions in these cases were given on particular facts of the matter, and no hard and fast rules or no general proposition of law was laid by the court with respect to the present issue of law. And therefore, he prayed for having a flexible rule wherein the right to fair investigation does not become a springboard for acquittal where investigations are proper and as per law. Now let's proceed and have a look at the submissions advanced by the Additional Solicitor General of India. So he contended that as per the investigation by complainant, aspects of investigation by complainant, that is to say, when the complainant himself carries on the investigation, then aspects of such a case can be given weightage to while assailing the evidence. But the mere factum of the investigating officer being the same person as the complainant cannot vitiate the trial itself altogether. The second contention was that the Mohanlal's case did not consider the scheme of the NDPS Act and also Section 157 of the CRPC. And the same was also contended here, that the provisions of CRPC will be applicable to the present matter as well. Thirdly, it was contended that prejudice and bias, it is to be established. It is not inferred. So even in cases of reverse burden, without foundational facts first being established, the provisions raising presumptions against accused cannot operate. The standard of proof on accused is only of preponderance of probabilities. And that is by this what was meant or intended by the additional Solicitor General was that in order for us to claim the defense of prejudice or bias, we need to first establish the foundational facts. Prejudice and bias cannot be inferred on itself. So the courts infer only in extraordinary cases that the abuse of power was there. And fourth and lastly, it was contended that reverse burden of proof is also available in IPC Section 304B, and IPC offenses are investigated under by the procedures provided for in the CRPC. And we've already looked up that CRPC does not discriminate or places a bar on the police officer who is the complainant from investigating the matter. So similarly, it was contended that law does not disapprove or frown upon this practice. Protections remain even when complainant or the investigating officer is the same. Now, finally, let's proceed and understand the reasoning and decision of the court. So the court stated that no reason to doubt informant's credibility or entire prosecution case solely because the informant has investigated the case. Prosecution version cannot be discarded and accused person cannot be acquitted merely on doubt. Secondly, it was stated that prejudice and bias is to be established and not inferred, and it is to be decided on the facts of each case. Thirdly, considering that no specific bar on conducting investigation by informant himself for offenses under IPC is provided for in the CRPC, and that safeguards are already in place in the NDPS Act, for instance, Section 58. And therefore, the court stated that there cannot be any general proposition of law that in every case where the informant is the investigator, the trial is vitiated and the accused is entitled to acquittal. Fourthly, it was stated that factors like proven bias of the informant come investigator, or to say whenever bias is proved against the complainant and the investigator, and if evidence other than the informant and the investigator's deposition were not relied upon by the prosecution, then such a fact coupled with the fact that the complainant himself conducted the investigation. So these factors, they can certainly be given weightage while assailing the evidence on record. So it is not like that these factors will be discarded altogether. No, they will be given due weightage while assailing the evidence, but mere factum of these factors cannot lead to the vitiation of the entire proceeding. And fifth, it was stated by the court that the court did not found it proper to lay unqualified proposition that in every case where the police officer who registers the FIR conducts the investigation, that itself had caused prejudice to the accused and thereby it vitiates the entire prosecution case and the accused is entitled to acquittal. So such a proposition cannot be laid down, or it was not held proper or deemed proper by the court. Then moving on, the court's observation plus acquittal of accused in cases of Bhagwan Singh, Megha Singh, State of Inspector of Police, NIB, or this the case of Tamil Nadu, State of Tamil Nadu. So on the ground that the trial was vitiated as informant and investigator was the same, it is to be treated to be confined to their own facts, and no general proposition of law was laid down in these cases. So the Supreme Court held that in these cases, the findings of the court was based on the particular facts of the matter, and there was no general proposition of law which was laid down. And it was thus held by the court that contrary decisions in Mohanlal and such other cases which are situated on the similar lining, they were held not good law and thus were specifically overruled by the court. Therefore, answering the issue of law in negative, the court held that merely because the informant is the investigator, By that itself, the investigation would not suffer the bias of unfairness or bias, and the accused would not be entitled to acquittal. So that's all we have for this analysis. At the end of the note, you will find a list of abbreviations which we have used in this note. So you may refer to them in order to get a clearer understanding of the matter. So that's all for this case. Thank you for being with us. And if you have any questions with respect to the note or the case law that we've analyzed today, kindly feel free to write the same in the chat box or the comment section, and we will revert back to the same. Thank you for being with us.